Number 838, Beautiful Savior. 838. And most likely on the third verse, Becky's going to drop out, and we're going to sing that a cappella. So let's see what can happen.
Good morning. These second and fourth Sundays are becoming my favorite because I just get to sit in the back and listen to the people of God sing praises. Isn't that just, that's just good. That's just good. So I welcome you to worship on this day. This is our last Sunday in the season of Epiphany. And if you know Epiphanies, it's when that sudden something clicks and we see something in a new way. And all through this whole season, January till now, we've been seeing God show up. And my prayer today is that you see God show up today in all God's glory, in all God's strength and power to remind you that you belong to the God who can do all things and that God knows and calls you beloved and strengthens you to live in this world with hope and with faith and with life that we can't get from here. So I welcome you to worship today. Whether you are here with us, if it's your first time, a special welcome to you. Everything you need is going to be on the screens. And the people next to you are generally nice. So if you have a question, you can always nudge them. This is your chance to prove yourself, Salem. You could always ask somebody around you what's happening. We also have our bulletin full of announcements. Make sure you read that as well. And then if you're worshiping with us online, God bless you where you sit. If it's a Sunday morning, you've got your hot cup of coffee and your slippers on, we're jealous. If it's a Thursday night and this is the time that you can make for God, God bless you. May you hear God's good word today too. We continue our worship with a time of giving God all of it. All the brokenness, all the worry, all the pain, all the fear, all the sin. And hearing God's words of grace and life for us. Wiping the slate clean and starting fresh. So we begin worship with confession. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the creator of darkness and light, the word of truth, the wind sweeping over the waters. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. I invite you to a few moments of private confession. And let us confess what's common for all of us. God, our rock and refuge, we pour out our hearts before you. We have known you, but have not always loved you. We have wounded one another and sinned against you. We have not always recognized the Holy Spirit dwelling in each of us. Remember your covenant. Renew your creation. Restore us that we might proclaim your good news to all. Amen. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters, and God has spoken. The time of grace is now. In Jesus, the reign of God has come near, and by the authority of Jesus Christ, I declare to you that all of your sins are forgiven. You are God's beloved. Amen. Because of this grace God has given us, we can live at peace. We live at peace with God and at peace with one another. So may the peace of the Lord be with you always. I invite you to stand, elbow bump, fist, smile, wave. Give a sign of God's peace in this community. God's praises, joining in our opening hymn. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let's join together in our prayer of the day. Almighty God, The resplendent light of your truth shines from mountaintop into our hearts. Transfigure us by your beloved Son and illumine the world with your image through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I invite you to be seated as our choir leads us in worship.
Salem family. Good morning. Our first reading today comes from 2 Kings chapter 2. Today's reading centers on the transfer of power and authority from the prophet Elijah to Elisha. Their travels, which retrace the path of Joshua back to Moab, the place where Moses died, and the parting of the waters, demonstrate that Elisha and Elijah are legitimate successors of the great prophet Moses. Now, when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives and as yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know, keep silent. Elijah said to him, Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho. But he said, as the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you. So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you? And he answered, Yes, I know. Be silent. Then Elijah said to him, Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan. But he said, As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you. So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you. Elisha said, Please, let me inherit a double share of your spirit. He responded, You have asked a hard thing. Yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not. As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen. But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. The word of the Lord. Please join me in the reading of Psalm 51 through 6. The Mighty One, God the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth. Our God comes and does not keep silence. Before him is the devouring fire and a mighty tempest all around him. He calls to the heavens above and to the earth that he may judge his people. Gather to me my faithful ones who made a covenant with me by sacrifice. The heavens declare the righteousness. God himself is judge. Selah. This ends the reading of the psalm. Our second reading comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 4. The spotlight of Christianity ministry, or Christian ministry, is not on the people who carry out ministry, but on the Lord Jesus Christ. Just as God made light shine at creation, God makes the light of Jesus Christ shine in our lives through Christian ministry. Paul writes, And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, let light shine out of darkness, who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
Stand and honor the words of Jesus.
Amen.
Our gospel reading today is from Mark chapter 9, verses 2 through 9. In it, Mark's gospel presents the Transfiguration as a preview of what it would become apparent to Jesus' followers after he rose from the dead. Confused disciples are given a vision of God's glory manifest in the beloved Son. So hear the word of God. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. "This is my Son, the Beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the gospel of the Lord. I invite you to be seated and our children to come forward for our children's message. I'm going to keep you guys in line today. No, I'm just kidding. Come on up. Does anybody know what this really cool thing is?
It's a staff.
It's a stick, right? It's a chunk of a tree. It's a special kind of tree. It's called a diamond willow. Everywhere that a branch starts to grow, it kind of creates this cool thing. So if you pull the branch off, isn't that cool? It's my favorite kind of wood. That and tiger maples. What would you use something this glorious for? A staff? What is a staff?
Walking.
For walking. Also for getting people to follow directions. There you go. See, it worked. Oh, no.
try to do it to me.
try to do it to you. You dare me. Now, there's good uses for this if you're going on a walk. Are there some bad uses for it? Was I demonstrating a bad use for it? Yeah, you don't hit people with a staff. Why does this help you go on a walk?
Because you can actually walk and not...
Delilah, how does that help you go for a walk? You don't have to walk so hard. Yeah, because if you're doing this, you have to have your own balance, and you got to keep walking, right? Sometimes if you have this, it can kind of help guide you, can it? Yeah. Do you want to hold it? Your mom picked you up? Wow. Have you guys ever been camping or gone somewhere and you found a stick and used it as your own walking stick?
Yes.
And you've used it as a sword, right? There's good ways and bad ways to use a stick. Yeah. How did it make you feel to have that walking stick that you made?
Good. Because then you can whack people.
No, we're not whacking people with our sticks. I'm going to use this to stand back up now. Ugh. Right? Having a stick along kind of makes you feel good, because... Yeah, so John said if you trip and fall, you can use the stick to pull up instead of getting your hands in the mud.
Well, you can right? Grab the stick and put it like this.
Yeah, stick it in the mud and then climb up. Cool. Have you ever gone through a thick part of the forest and used your stick to open up the path in front of you?
Yeah.
Or like to get a tree branch out of the way so it didn't whack you in the face?
I did that before and it just goes like this and then... Bam.
Now, can you do all those things without a walking stick? If you fall down, can you get back up?
Yeah.
For the most part. I'm talking to kids. If you fall down, you can usually get back up, can't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. And if you're walking through something that has big branches in the way, can you move them with your own hand?
Yeah.
This makes it a bit easier, doesn't it?
Okay.
It's something to lean on, something to give you extra help. Jesus goes walking with his disciples up a mountain. I'm pretty sure that they got a walking stick because going up a mountain is hard. And it's nice to have a little extra help going uphill, right? My turn. And then when they get to the top, something changes with Jesus. His clothes that are usually kind of dirty because you're walking around in the dust turn whiter than what I'm wearing. Can you imagine that? It turns blinding light, yeah. And Jesus changes in front of them and shows them God's goodness, the brightness of following God. And the disciples are a little afraid. They don't know what's happening. Uh-huh. And Peter says, well, I'll build some tents and we can just stay up here and figure this whole thing out. And then, as soon as he says that, there's a voice that says, this is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. It's almost like God's giving them a walking stick in who Jesus is. We can get up out of the mud by ourselves, but it's nice to have that help. Jesus, we can live our life by ourselves, but God is with us to help us out of the mud and help us to go up the hill and do the hard things. God is with us in a way that is stronger than any walking stick would be. Now, when Gary made this, he also put this thing on here. Can I read it to you?
Sure.
Because it is something that's amazing. He's made a lot of these. So this is about Psalm 23. Psalm 23 says that it talks about how when we're afraid, God is with us. That when we are worried about things, God is with us. That God is there to help us and sets a big feast for us to help take care of us. That when we're worried, he gives us a nice, safe place to be. And this says, this stick helps remind us of God's compassion, God's care for us, that the way a shepherd takes care of his sheep. This is about God's power and his authority and the way that we can hang on to God in the times that we are afraid or that we are unsteady. So the next time that you guys pick out a stick to go on a walk with, I want you to think about it as God walking right beside you and helping you when things are hard and being with you through all of it. Are you ready to pray with me? All right. Dear God, thank you for your love that shows up in ways I can see and in ways I can't even see. Help me lean on you and trust you're with me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good job. Thank you guys for coming up. You can grab, we've got coloring things for you to take back to your seat. No, you cannot take my stick with you. No, that's mine. Oh, that's helpful. I might use that every Sunday now. Well, this has been a glorious Epiphany season. Glorious in the way that God's glory is on display. In all the scriptures that we've heard from January till now, we see all these ways that God is present in a unique way in Jesus. So from the very beginning of the year, when the Magi come and bring gifts, to Jesus being called God's beloved son in his baptism, as the waters washed over him, we heard the same words that we hear at his transfiguration, at that changing. From the scriptures of Jesus calling his disciples to come and follow, to Jesus lifting people up, freeing them from demons and healing them in order to serve as a response of love, we see God's power at work in our own lives. And if these scriptures did what they're supposed to do, the people who have heard them have a deeper trust in God. of God's care for them in all ways and in all places. Every single Sunday, we hear that. And every time that those scriptures open, that's what it's trying to do, is to stir up faith and trust within you. But it doesn't seem week after week to always do that for us, does it? Sometimes we kind of need those epiphany moments, those poof moments where things kind of fall into place. We need something that reminds us that God is present. Because hearing it week after week doesn't always sink in, does it? I wonder what that was like for the disciples who were with Jesus every day, who saw these things happen every day. I wonder if they ever got sick of it. In fact, I think that they did, because there were a few times where the people come for healing and the disciples try to turn them away. We need a break. And over again, we see these people coming for healing, and we see how Jesus embodies God to the world, how Jesus shows up and brings God's presence everywhere he goes. But every once in a while, for the disciples and for us, there's a moment where things click. Right before our reading today, Jesus has asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And he gets a nice long list. There's some people think you're a prophet. Some people think that you're John the Baptizer, reincarnated or brought back to life somehow. And Jesus looks at Peter and says, "But who do you say that I am?" And Peter looks at him and says, "You are the Christ. You are the one who's been anointed, picked out, handpicked by God to do something amazing." And Jesus tells them all to be quiet and begins to teach them that being God's anointed means death. It means suffering and dying, and it means rising again. Something that's so far beyond any of their ability to understand that Jesus has to repeat it a few different times, and I still don't think that they got it. But on that morning, 6 days after Peter had said, "You are the Christ," 6 days later, Jesus calls the three of them for morning prayer. I imagine they grab a stick and they head up a mountain. The other disciples are left to kind of break camp as they get ready to head on to the next town. And Jesus travels up the mountain with James and John and Peter, three of the closest that he brings along for all kinds of prayer. And as they're rising this mountain, something about Jesus changes. It's transfigured. It's completely transformed from what they know of him. And he begins to shine with some unearthly light that washes over them in waves. I'm sure they can't even look at him, brighter than the sun. And in that moment, as they squint against that light, they see the heroes of their faith, Moses and Elijah. These are Old Testament characters. Moses being the one who freed God's people from slavery. But that's not why he's important. Moses is the one who first received God's laws to give to God's people. After being freed from Israel, they all go up a mountain. Moses travels on further and gets the new relationship God hopes for God's people. A relationship that says, this is how you relate to God, and this is how you relate to each other. Now that you're free, this is what you do with your freedom. And Moses carries them back down, and in a whole new way, God shows that God cares about what happens in people's lives. God cares that you get rest. God cares that you respect the relationships that you're in. God cares that you spend time at rest in God's presence in worship. God cares that you don't look at what other people have, but are content with the gifts God has given you. That God cares about our lives. That's all that Moses encompasses, the law, the good guidance of our God. And then there's Elijah, a story that we heard, one that I love, of the passing of the mantle to Elisha. But Elijah, the powerful one who brought God back to people and brought people back to God. Elijah stands as the prophet of prophets. See, when God gave laws and gave these rules and invited people into this new relationship, it was a hard road. And so God would send people that would keep pointing back to following God. The prophet's only job was to point at the God who loves the people and wants to be known. Moses and Elijah, and now with Jesus shining between them, it's almost like God is bringing together everything that God has done in the past into the present. That Jesus changing and speaking with Moses and Elijah is like God putting all of it together to show us how God wants to transform the relationship that God has with us. Not one based on rules and on order, but one that's based on trust. That looks to God not just for what should I do right now with my life, but trust that even in the uncertainty, God is with you. God is looking to change the way we think about our relationship with God. And I wonder if that's ever happened to you. Those kind of epiphany moments where all of a sudden everything that you've thought about God kind of shifts a little bit. That all the rules that you've lived by, your heart suddenly becomes part of that. And you go from something that you know about God because you might have read scripture and studied it, or you remember something from confirmation, bless you if you do, but all of a sudden it comes from something that you know to something that you know deep in your gut about how God feels about you. Have you ever had a moment like that? Where it comes from out there to right home, where God shows up and feels close. Maybe you're waiting for one of those moments. Maybe you've had them in the past, but you need them right now to know that God is there, that God cares. I think we all yearn for that mountaintop. We all yearn for a journey that then takes us closer to God. That we're all hoping to have this shiny moment where God is close, where things are certain, where our lives feel like they matter and our questions kind of fall away. I think we yearn for that. And I think if and when we find it, we're tempted to stay there. I think we're just like Peter, who blurts out, "Lord, this is good. I like that we're here. We're in this great spot where I feel like I know and I've got it together and I trust you and I got this. Let's build some tents and just hang out here for a while." I think we want that buzz of having that spiritual moment on the mountaintop where we feel all certain. We want to hang on to that. But that is not the substance of our life. Those mountaintops are not the substance of our faith. They may be great for those moments that we live in them, but that is not what faith is. There's a cloud that hovers around the guys. And there's a voice that speaks and reorients them to what they should be paying attention to. "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." We might want those mountaintops. We might want those places where we feel like we know. But it's in listening to Jesus. That's where our faith is. It's not in our feelings and our experiences. It's in the hope that we hear from Jesus. The one who, in what he says and what he does, points us to who God is. That God comes to us with forgiveness and with mercy. That God does not come to us with judgment, but with grace. God who comes to us to try and rebuild this relationship that is based on loving and trusting God and loving and caring for each other. Jesus who comes and shows us that God has mercy on all of us, the greatest and the least of us, and that God invites us to have mercy on each other, the greatest, but so much more the least of us. That God is working within us to create hope and healing for us and for our neighbor. Jesus shows us that God comes and tries to separate us from our demons and our habits and the ruts that we get stuck into so that we can know what it is to live free, trusting in God, not in our own work. Jesus, who shows us that even the hardest and the most fear-filled and pain-filled moments, like death and our own destruction, do not outmatch the power that God has. And Jesus rises from the dead. We see God in Jesus, who is working on bringing joy and delight in who we have in our relationship with God and in how we can relate to each other. Because our faith is not found on a mountaintop. Our faith and the substance of faith is trusting God when we're down here. It's trusting God when things are falling apart. Our faith is found when we say, God, you're the only one I've got to lean on. Thanks be to God that our experience doesn't dictate our faith. May the peace of God, which surpasses all our understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. If you're able, I invite you to stand, and we'll sing together the songs of our faith. We confess the trust we have in God, in what God has done, what God is doing, and what God will do, as we use the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I invite you to be seated. As we celebrate Christ embodied on our earth, we pray for God's blessing, for the church, for the world, and for all those who have need this day. Almighty God, we pray for your church, that you transform us into images of your Son, who know that you are within your Son and within us. May your power enter our hearts, that we may trust you above all else. Merciful God, receive our prayer. We pray for your creation, that we will humbly observe the swirl of wind and the heat of the sun in whatever season this currently is. Teach us to honor all that you've made and to care for the animals, the plants, the air, and the water of this planet. Merciful God, receive our prayer. We pray for those who are charged with leadership, lawmakers, the governances of our towns, our states, our countries, that they will strive for goodness and justice all the days of their lives and callings. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Guide us to offer hospitality, shelter, friendship, and care to any who are in need. We pray for any who are sick and suffering. We pray especially for Nancy Schmidt as we wait for you to welcome her into your arms. We pray for those who are grieving, Glenn and Chrissy, for all those who are in need of healing, for Jacob, for Mary as she prepares for surgery this week, for Bev, Linda, and Melissa, for all those who rest on our hearts that we lift to you now. May they lean on you in their struggles, and may we point to your hope. Merciful God, receive our prayer. We pray for Salem and our ministries within these walls and to our wider community. Bless the work of Salem West and the Mustard Seed. May we all share the transforming beauty and love of God in ways that honor the dignity of all whom we encounter. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Knowing the Holy Spirit is the one who prays in our midst, we offer these prayers, the one silently on our hearts, trusting God that you hear them all and respond in the same mercy that we've seen in Christ our Lord. Amen. This time we bring our gifts to God in honor of God's work within us and trust that God is the one that provides for our future.
Our vain ambitious worry, come to Christ.
Thank you, Barb. Let's join together in our offering prayer. Blessed are you, Holy One, for all good things come from you. In bread and cup, you open heaven to us. Meet us at this table, that we receive what we seek and follow your Son, Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. In this meal is the promise of God's strength and God's presence with us everywhere that we go. In the night in which he was handed over, our Lord Jesus took bread, and he blessed it and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us join in the prayer our Lord Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You'll be invited to come forward by our ushers, receive and eat the bread, and then to take of the cup. If you have need, we have gluten-free wafers. The outside rings in the tray have red wine. The inside circle has white grape juice, so please take what you are comfortable with. And these small cups can be placed in the baskets that are on either side of our sanctuary. All those who believe that Christ is present in this meal are welcome here at God's table. So come eat, be filled with the grace and mercy of our God. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. And the grace and peace of our God come upon you today and stay with you always. Amen. God bless the little children as you go off to Sunday school. May you learn and grow. And the big kids. All right, fine. May you learn and grow. May you learn how Jesus calms the storms today. It's a really fun video. I already watched it. So you guys can head off to Sunday school. Thank you for being part of worship today. We will see you after church. So we have just a few announcements today that I'm aware of. Who knows? Okay. First is that our giving statements are all in our mailboxes. If you haven't picked it up yet or you're not able to, we're going to be mailing them out this week. So as you head back for fellowship time, for cookies and coffee and hi, how's it going, grab those out of your mailboxes as you go, please. Also, if you haven't picked up our February newsletter, we've got a ton of things happening in church as Lent begins this Wednesday. Lent is a season of returning to God, and we begin with an Ash Wednesday service at 6:30 on Valentine's Day. So I get that there's a little bit of competition, but I invite you to return to your first love this year. To return to God in this season. We'll be worshiping at 6:30. If confession in the morning feels like it's not enough, Ash Wednesday is for you. It's a time to remember that we are mortal. We are finite. We cannot do everything that this world puts on us, that we put on ourselves, or that God invites us into. But it's God who invites us into relationship. So I invite you to join in this Lenten season. Worship's on Wednesday evenings at 6:30, a meal at 5:15 after Ash Wednesday. It's just a season to slow down, to hear the promises that God makes us. And if you want more information, that is in those newsletters. So please grab that as you go, or you can see it on our website, salemdwd.org. We are looking for our next Parents' Night Off adult supervisors. We asked for 4 adults to be here to provide some free childcare for people in our community. That would be a cleaning night for me, because then the kids aren't going to walk over what I have wet and clean on the floor. I'm not sure what other parents do. Maybe they get to go out and have a nice night. But it's a great way to offer a little extra support to families in our community. So if you would like to be an adult, if you would like to be an adult, that helps. Please let us know. We let you guys set the date. We let you pick the activities. So if you would like to be an adult that just puts on a movie and makes popcorn, That is acceptable and wonderful as a way to serve our community. So please come let me know or call the church office. If you want, you can get your other adults along with that and do that together as a group. We look for about 2 hours on a Tuesday or Thursday night. So let me know if you are interested in that. Other announcements. Noreen, please come up.
I'll try not to take up too much time because I have a very low voice today. I just want to say thank you to everyone who made treats and things for the bake sale. It was unbelievable what you guys did. And the people in the whole community, I couldn't believe it. And as we were running out, if you've been back in the kitchen area, you've seen a whole table full of things. As we were running out, all of a sudden, someone would say, oh, someone just brought in a whole bunch of things, and we need to replate them and do all this stuff. And so we've got a lot of stuff. And anyway, it goes to our Honduras missions. Everything back there is, you can take what you want, and if you would like to leave a donation, we would definitely appreciate it. There's a donation jar there, and it goes to our Honduras missions. And we just appreciate everything that you all did. It's just amazing. They were really good. Thank you so much. Oh, Ian treats that are there in the little glass dishes with the little cup. There's a tea bag in the cup and everything. And those are just neat. You can get several of them and have a tea party at your house, or you can get one and give it to a neighbor who lives alone or whatever and just say, I've been thinking about you, or take it to a nursing home or, you know, whatever and give it to somebody. So we have a bunch of them too. Thank you.
It is Salem's turn to lead worship at the CRMC Care Center at 1:30 today. So if you would like to come join, be part of that, bring residents to the activity center as we do prayer together, sing a few songs, and hear scripture. So anyone is welcome to come and help out and be part of that today at 1:30. Are there any other announcements and ways we're using our faith this week? Then I will see you Wednesday for Ash Wednesday service. I invite you to stand as we begin, as we receive God's blessing and go into this world God loves. May the Lord bless and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. God look on you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us join together in our sending song, Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Thank you.
Go in peace. You are God's beloved. Thanks be to God. Have a wonderful week.